Good evening, everyone. My name is Josh Owen. I'm the Massimo and Lella Vignelli Distinguished Professor of Design and the Director of the Vignelli Center for Design Studies. I'm delighted to welcome you to the third lecture of this year's Vignelli Design Conversations series, presented by Design Milk and made possible in part by the generosity of RIT alumnus Chris Bailey and Bailey Brand Consulting. Rochester Institute of Technology's Vignelli Center for Design Studies is an international hub for education, research, collaboration, and advocacy, which expands the scope of programs in the College of Art and Design School of Design. The facility houses the archive of renowned designers Lella and Massimo Vignelli, whose works are icons of international design. The center and archives sit within RIT's College of Art and Design, which was built on the traditional territory of the Onondaga, or people of the Great Hill. In English, they're known as Seneca people, the keepers of the Western Door. They're one of the six sovereign nations that make up the Haudenosaunee Confederacy. We honor the land on which RIT was built and recognize the unique relationship that the indigenous stewards have with this land. That relationship is the core of their traditions, cultures, and histories. We recognize the history of genocide, colonization, and assimilation of indigenous people that took place on this land. Mindful of these histories, we work towards understanding, acknowledging, and reconciling. As stewards of history and content, we must acknowledge and seek to learn from our context, bad and good, ugly and beautiful. This applies to the Vignelli Center, as with any archive. The Vignellis taught us that design is a systematic framework for solving the world's most intractable problems. If 2020 has taught us anything, it's that while we as humans are adaptable, our societies and systems have major flaws. We're at a point when we need to have difficult discussions and work to create a new balance in the world. In this, design must play a critical role. As the new director, I aim to make the Vignelli Center even more accessible and applicable by bringing in exciting guest contributors from diverse and underrepresented backgrounds who are using design in innovative ways. The Vignelli's Design is One philosophy leaves us with a universal message that design is a lens through which we can envision a more inclusive tomorrow. Before introducing our third guest of this year's lecture series, I'd like to take a few moments to set the stage. Out of respect for our presenter, participants will be muted for the duration of the event, but we do encourage you to enter questions you have for our presenter using the Q&A feature, and we'll try to get to as many of them as possible during our closing Q&A segment. To begin, I'd like to share with you how honored I am to welcome my good friend and esteemed colleague, Milton S. F. Curry, this evening. Milton is a remarkable individual, adept at many things, as you will learn tonight. One of the characteristics I most admire about him is his exceptional ability to galvanize meaningful opportunities that advance critical discourse and create impact. In 2006, when Milton was teaching at Cornell University's architecture program and was also the director of the Cornell Council for the Arts, Milton invited me as a Cornell alum and a former CCA grant recipient to give a lecture to the art, architecture, and planning community. This talk framed a conversation around an innovative hybrid architecture and sculpture course entitled Objects in Space. This class was taught by my former sculpture professor, Roberto Bertoia, and architecture professor, Andrea Simich, who are both special guests listening in to tonight's program. As a visiting critic, I worked with Milton, Andrea, and Roberto and their interdisciplinary students to bring their collective project to New York City as part of Design Week that year. Their project was well received and was distinguished by a feature in the New York Times. After the success of that collaboration, Milton and I have stayed in touch and invariably connect each year in New York City during Design Week. No matter where Milton is physically anchored in his career, he seems always to make time to visit that important annual event where one can find him studying the landscape of ideas coming from both industry and academic sectors, looking to create meaningful change using design discourse as his medium. More recently, when RIT's current president, David Munson, was inaugurated, I received a note from Milton telling me that we were lucky to have him. Milton and Dave served in leadership roles together, overlapping during their time at the University of Michigan. President Munson is also listening in tonight and offers his warm welcome to you, Milton. Milton S. F. Curry is Dean and Professor at the University of Southern California School of Architecture and holds the Della and Harry McDonald Dean's Chair in Architecture. Dean Curry is an academic leader and an accomplished scholar and designer. He has edited and co-edited several journals and has authored influential essays and articles related to architecture, urbanism, race, and cultural theory. Dean Curry worked at the offices of KPF Architects prior to establishing his own design practice, where he worked on built projects in New York and Ithaca, unbuilt projects in Oakland, and exhibition projects, including his works in the 2004 Studio Museum in Harlem exhibition on Harlem. He has organized symposia and conferences at Design Miami, Zona Maco, Mexico City, and at academic institutions such as Cornell University and University of Michigan. Dean Curry believes in public discourse on architecture and culture and is a popular international lecturer. He's been cited and published in Huffington Post, Architects Newspaper, Architectural Record, and many other venues. Dean Curry obtained his master's in architecture degree with distinction from Harvard Graduate School of Design and his Bachelor of Architecture degree from Cornell University. He's held teaching positions at Arizona State, Cornell University, Harvard, and University of Michigan. Dean Curry is committed to the innately democratic project of the American University and believes that architecture thinking is critical to the Academy's role in advancing contemporary discourse on cultural inclusion and social impact. Please join me in a big virtual welcome for the prolific and impactful Milton S. F. Curry.
Thank you, Josh. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. Can you see that okay?
Looks good.
Great. Well, thank you, RIT, the Vanelli Center, for inviting me, and Design Milk, your co-sponsor. Thank you to Dave Munson, who was a good friend when I was in leadership at University of Michigan, and you're grateful. Lucky to have him. And thank you, Josh. You're a great friend, introduced to me in some ways by Roberta Vittoria, your professor at Cornell, and really enjoyed the friendship and the dedication that you've shown in your field, in our field of design. And it's been extraordinary to see the things you've done at RIT since you've been there, and the things that you're going to do that I know will be innovative, experimental, and impactful at the Vanelli Center. So it's great to see you again. I'm very pleased to speak this evening, and I want to just say that you know, I've been engaged in, as Josh said, in the intellectual project of modernism, race, urbanism, and cultural theory for quite some time, and you know, it's great to see these issues of racial justice and social justice coming front and center now. But many of us have been working on these for a long time. And I think for me, it's very important to kind of contextualize that work with the newfound consciousness that we're having in this moment. So it's great to be able to share some thoughts with you this evening. As you all know, the current and recent tragedies of police brutality have brought to the surface issues of race and white supremacy. But what it has also brought front and center is the nature of urban life for Black Americans, Latinx Americans, Indigenous Americans, and persons of color all across the country. And that brings to the surface issues of residential segregation, public policy and urban planning, urban design, and the architecture of the very communities in which persons of color live in. And what I want to do this evening is kind of two things. One is to read some excerpts from a portion of an essay that will be forthcoming in an exhibition catalog at the upcoming exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art in New York entitled Black Reconstructions. And this will be a work of 10 Black architects that have been selected and commissioned to do work exploring the contemporary issues around Black America and architecture and design in February of next year. And I was asked to be on the advisory board and to write an essay in the exhibition catalog. So I'll read from a portion of that this evening. The second thing I will do is to have a conversation with you and, in fact, myself, as strange as that sounds, about Paul Williams and the archive that our university has been fortunate to co-acquire with the Getty Foundation, the Getty Research Institute. And that conversation is really just beginning. I'll tell you a little bit about the archives, how large it is, what it contains. And I say the conversation with you and me because the archive is still in pallets at the storage facility, and it's going to be over the next 18 months that we actually unfold that, open up the archives, begin to scan, digitize, and see exactly what the depth of the work that's there. And so the conversation is about applying the theoretical framework that I'll introduce this evening around architecture race theory onto someone like Paul Williams. And I say like because there are many Black architects whose work has not been sufficiently theorized or historicized that fall within the historical period that Paul Williams is in, but also earlier, mostly earlier and slightly later than him. So I'm going to kind of have a conversation about how we might think about Paul Williams in light of some of the theoretical framings that I'll help him for. So towards an architecture race theory is a kind of title here. I'm going to quote from Mark Bradford that I always find compelling. And he says, I want to engage, this is Mark Bradford's work. I want to engage a social, political conversation about the contemporary world that I live in or my relationship to it. And at the same time, I want to abstract it. And another quote by Paul Taylor from a book entitled Black is Beautiful, A Philosophy of Black Aesthetics. He says, quote, race is central to the modern project, but the point should actually be stronger. Modernity was, in significant ways, a racial project, end quote. And I bring those two quotes together because we look at, in effect, a kind of autopsy of the modern American city, such as Detroit or Los Angeles. It reveals a protocol of containment and estrangement, if you will, that continue to haunt the Black subject, many other marginalized subjects within the urban context and their collective progress. The idealized versions of the American meritocracy, democracy, and equality of opportunity have by now been exposed as myths. In the United States, the twin circumstances of post-colonial city building and the importing of European modernism produced paradoxes at the outset that have proven resistant to change. These protocols of containment include environmental racism, the undervaluing of Black American residential communities, deficits in public infrastructure, and public education. From the dramatic description of Harriet Jacobs's Garret, as described in Incidents in the Life of a Slave Girl, to the expressive imaging of Black American life in Kerry James Marshall's Mastery series, to other Black aesthetic interrogations of Blackness, the interior space of Black American life is in many ways where culture has been materialized. It's no doubt still the place where the most marginalized populations find their unique countercultural voice expressed through the aesthetic construction of their interior spaces and lives. Yet paradoxically, the urban realm becomes in a way a counter narrative for Black Americans as they vow to have some identification with the physical space, albeit a space where they're living in sheer terror, in violence, enforced by, in some cases, the state. Suburbia, on the other hand, was and has been imagined and built as a literal white space, excluded to populations of color. Of course, that's changing. This is idealized in the literatures of the 1920s and onward as outlined by literary theorists like Madhu Dubey, Catherine Yurka, and Walter Ben Michaels, among others. So therefore, the elision of racial theory from a foundational understanding of the discipline of architecture, even in the face of social movements and upheavals that centralize racial identity as key to larger struggles associated with social justice and equality and modernity, is catastrophic. And I think that still continues. And I'll try to interrogate that a little bit in this talk. At MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art, they have a show called The New City in 1968 with all white participants from five Ivy League schools that were looking at what could be the future, how could you speculate on Harlem. And in contrast to the New City exhibition and other exhibitions at MoMA, Reconstructions, which opens next year, which features the work of 10 black architects, artists, and designers from the African diaspora, attempts to register an awareness of the absence of black Americans in the production of architecture and design thinking. And I think this is a real opening. The exhibition calls upon American history following the Civil War, in which specific laws were intended to address racial inequity, including the 14th Amendment, one of the so-called Reconstruction Amendments, which guarantees all citizens equal protection under the law. Yet, as Eric Foner states in the Second Founding, quote, a state action interpretation of the 14th Amendment can be debilitating. It's been used, for example, in rulings that do not allow race to be taken into account on the grounds that segregation today results not from laws, as in the past, but from private choices that produced racially homogenous housing patterns. The contested intellectual history of Reconstruction has taught us that structural racism and private racist actions cannot be extricated from a society by laws alone. Social activism and social movements are necessary components of social change. The curatorial charge of Reconstructions, then, amid a global return to authoritarianism, fascism, xenophobia, and racism, compels us to ask what cognitive conditions are necessary to think anew about the production, about the productive roles race and blackness can play in conceptualizing future imaginings of cities and societies. How can work by these 10 architects, artists, and designers sharpen our collective understanding of blackness and urbanism and simultaneously decenter the dominance of the white gaze? Now, I want to talk a little bit about something I'm calling epistemic primitivism. And to get there, I'll start with saying in the last 30 years or so, race-integrated scholarship, theoretical scholarship, has made disciplinary interventions in multiple fields, ranging from law to literature, that recognize the maturity and intellectual dignity of the Black subject. There have been a lot of interventions that are made that we need to recognize. Works such as Madhu Dubey's Signs in Cities, Black Literary Postmodernism, Catherine Yurka's White Diaspora, The Suburb and the 20th Century Novel, and Alan Reed's The Fact of Blackness, Franz Fanon, and Visual Representation, successfully bring cultural theory and a deep interrogation of racial consciousness into the realm of the visual. Within architecture, authors such as Mabel Wilson, Daryl Fields, and Mario Gooden have likewise leveraged work in visual culture and racial identity, formulating unique perspectives on modern architecture's deep systems of logic that continue to embed a negative racialized consciousness into the theorizing and making of architecture and urban design. Yet even with robust intellectual production in race-integrated scholarship on architecture, there remains an epistemic primitivism in the systemic exclusion of this work in mainstream architecture theory. Epistemology is the philosophical concept of how knowledge comes into being, how we understand knowledge, and how we establish conditions for knowledge production, and how societal groups are included or excluded in the entire enterprise. Epistemic primitivism, for me, defines the way in which mainstream architectural theorists, and by extension the discipline, have excluded a comprehensive race-integrated approach to the study of architecture, urbanism, and aesthetics. Now, philosophers George Hegel, Randa Fricker, and Christy Dotson have each authored original texts on epistemology. And I want to go, stick with me here, I want to go through some of these. I'll do it in, I think, as plain language as I can, but I'll start with Hegel. Hegel's conservative notions place the individual's value to society actually in society's hands, while Fricker and Dotson, contemporary theorists and philosophers, radicalize the notion of social power and knowledge production. Hegel's incomplete individual is made whole by society's affirmation of his identity. You move out into society, and society affirms your social value. Now, for colonialized, marginalized subjects, that can be debilitating and even demoralizing when society doesn't accept you or places a value that's less than human on your person. In Hegel's conception of social theory, which in essence states that, according to scholar Fred Neuhauser, says, quote, since unformed subjects lack even the aspiration to be free, they lack the knowledge of their true essence and the desire to achieve it. It is in the interest to the nature of forming that maturity that it take place unconsciously and involuntarily behind the back, so to speak, of the very subjects who undergo the process of formation. If this sounds like something out of the colonialism textbook, it is. Who's ready for freedom? Who decides who's ready for freedom and how they're going to take freedom and deal with it, whether that's post-colonial or post-slavery? What Hegel leaves out of this equation is the invisible power dynamic that marginalizes the individual as a primitive subject, unable to operate cognitively with independence. Randa Fricker's notion of epistemic injustice is that power constructs social relations in ways that lower the credibility of marginal subjects and relegates their social identity as prejudicially lower in stature than the powerful higher class subject. Christy Dotson, another philosopher, works on what she calls epistemic oppression, in which she articulates that unequal participation in the activities that actually shape the categories through which we understand the world makes some people's lives less intelligible. We understand them less. And when those lives are less intelligible, it means that those lives are more easily dismissed and their value dismantled by higher status groups. White supremacy and other racial or ethnic claims to innate higher worth and status rely heavily on these tactics. They're oppressive and they're marginalizing, and these are the things that we need to continually pay attention to. I want to go to kind of theoretical analogs that we can look to in terms of how race-integrated scholarship has worked in other disciplines and how it can work in ours. Theorization does not take place in a vacuum. In defining a new frame of reference for a comprehensive race-integrated approach to the discipline of architecture, two theoretical analogs offer examples of successful radical disciplinary interventions that have proved sustainable over time. Critical race theory and critical race psychology, both of which index a race-integrated approach toward disciplinary interventions in cultural theory and psychology, respectively, and show how the coupling of whiteness and Eurocentrism achieves a simultaneous invisibility, power, and centeredness all at once. These innovative frameworks do more than index race and racism within their respective disciplines. They each demystify and dismantle canonical assumptions, open up new questions, and affirm new territories of theoretical thought across a constellation of ideological perspectives. Contemporary architecture theory is actually fairly new. It emerged in the late 1960s out of the shadows of both architectural history, strictly historical accounts of how buildings were designed and what historical typologies they fit into, and architectural criticism, how buildings were interpreted and used. Architecture theory's critical period, from the late 1980s to the 1990s, and some would say continuing, coincided with the burgeoning of cultural theory, cultural studies, ethnic and area studies, and gender and feminist studies within the academy. Yet unlike critical race theory and critical race psychology, architecture theory really evacuated political and racial content, predominantly by focusing on the semiotic nature of architecture's visual language and the formation of building typologies through the manipulations of architectural form. The ascension of form and language in semiotics instead of bodies and subjects precluded architecture theory from realizing the intellectual breakthroughs achieved by other disciplines that foregrounded subjectivity, human subjectivity, as something innately related to social construction and social power. Work in architecture theory focused on a race-integrated approach emerged in the early 1990s and has since evolved into a recognizable knowledge field, yet without the kind of coherent historical and institutional framing of other discursive movements, such as deconstruction, which you've probably heard of, cultural theory itself, critical race theory, and feminist theory. The positions articulated since on race and architecture are neither ideologically homogeneous nor consistently progressive, and they emanate from a diverse set of theorists. Most are Black, but not all. Just as the critical race theory movement developed out of solidarity and discord with the critical legal studies movement, so too can a movement to enrich the architecture discipline through a thorough examination of race be both indebted to innovative scholarship within architecture theory and at the same time opposed to many of its tenets. Formalism, semiotics, we can appropriate innovative frameworks and also be opposed to some of the tenets of those same frameworks. Groundbreaking theoretical work in architecture and race is informed by theoretical models developed during the critical theory period of the mid-1980s to the early 1990s. Yet many scholars exhaust the tools available within mainstream architecture theory and resort to other knowledge fields that have developed a richer and more nuanced reading of race, identity, visual culture, aesthetics, law, and urbanism. In other words, the history of race-integrated scholarship in architecture being so recent means that there's not as much to draw upon. And so scholars have looked to other disciplines such as art, art history, law, et cetera, where there's more of a rich theoretical work to draw in history to draw upon. So let me, I'm going to go through more slides, but let me get through a little bit more of the textual work here, and then I think things will make sense. I just want to frame out what I'm calling architecture race theory, and I'm working on a larger construct leading out of this essay. Architecture race theory, to me, is a new terminology and conceptual frame for a discursive movement that, in fact, has already begun. It defines a constellation of scholarship and creative work at the forefront of decentering dominant and hegemonic gazes through which modernist and postmodernist theories of architecture have emerged. It also defines a projective scholarship and creative work that can set forth imaginaries, speculative imaginaries of space and form that reposition Black and African diaspora identities in particular as worthy of inclusion into a new mainstream of architectural discourse. And it's a conceptual frame that unabashedly embraces a political leftist agenda to radically transform institutions and fundamental conceptions of power within the discipline and practice of architecture. Architecture race theory then insists upon a critical approach to the methodologies of teaching and practicing architecture, inviting more narrative-based methods of ascertaining the projective impacts of our creative work on actual human subjects, in demanding disciplinary reliance upon more race-conscious sociological data and information to inform particularly urban-scale decisions. The core tenets, if I could put it in a package of four things that would compose or would comprise architecture race theory, they would be the following. First, to use critical theory as a reparative intellectual method for making race visible in canonical American and European architecture discourses. That is, to use the tools of critical theory to repair the damage that has been done by the exclusion of race-integrated approaches in our architectural history, architectural theory, architectural criticism, architectural and urban design. Secondly, to use critiques of neoliberalism and capitalism to analyze the role of space in producing inequity. To look at the impacts, the disproportionate impacts of a radically market-oriented economy that looks at subjects as consumers or deliverers of labor exclusively, to use the critique of that radicalized notion of market-based capitalism to analyze how that, coupled with race, has produced inequality and inequity. Third, to use the creative and analytical tools of architecture thinking and design to reintroduce a race-integrated imagination. When I hear talk of diversity and racial and social equity, that's great. But there's also the speculative, creative, and experimental dimension of thinking anew about how race and culture and ethnicity can actually inspire new cultural forms, new aesthetic forms. It's not simply a kind of penalty for being racist. It's actually a way to open our minds and think about new kinds of cultural production that can actually emerge from a consciousness that is freed of racialized and racist practices. And fourth, to instrumentalize the exceptional global narrative of the African diaspora as fundamental to the evolution of egalitarianism as an ideological concept and core to the democratic ideal. That is to say that there's something about the subjectivity of African diaspora populations that arrive in colonial structures, that emerge out of those structures and become the canaries in the coal mine, so to speak, of a better world, of an egalitarian framework, of a more ethical framework of being and of treating other human beings. And that is an exceptional contribution of the African diaspora. There are contributions of other diaspora, but that happens to be one I believe that is exceptional when you look at the history of racialized slavery, racial capitalism, and colonialism. That population has emerged as producing exceptional contributions to discussion of egalitarianism for everyone and ethical framework of how you treat other people. Architecture race theory functioning as a platform for rigorous interdisciplinary theoretical work can support retrospective theory, reparative theory, contemporary theory addressing the present, perspective theory addressing an imaginative future. And some promising areas of thought for architecture race theory include urbanization in Black cities, media representations of social housing, Blackness aesthetics in the city, social movements, thinking about artistic and literary imaginaries and how those can be translated visually, textually. New theories about the estrangement that we feel within the neoliberal city, even perhaps more so today when we're not socially gathering. The uncanny discontinuities between the global and the local, and the various network socialities embedded in each are the kinds of historically infused critical inquiries that can and should be produced by architectural theorists. Likewise, architecture theory, using a synergistic approach of both burrowing into the spatial mechanics of public housing unit types, for example, within public housing, and then jump cutting to the managed adjacent urban landscape, contrasting that with landscapes in other neighborhoods, I believe can open up thinking and help to realize new imaginaries for these under-designed and poorly designed spaces that need repair. Architecture race theory functioning as an intellectual bridge between art theory and practices could also be another productive trajectory for new scholarship. I'm remembering W.E.B. Du Bois wrote the famous essay, the canonical essay, Criteria for a Negro Art, a provocative essay on the responsibility of Black contemporary artists to locate artistic expression within and alongside their struggle for freedom and the ideals of an egalitarian society. He could not have imagined the diversity of Black modernist and contemporary artists, such as Mark Bradford, Lynn Ligon, and Adam Pendleton, whose works are expansively political and abstract at the same time. Architecture, however, was never thought about as part of the Black arts tradition, nor is it now thought of as having the same status as contemporary Black art, which is exploding in a kind of renaissance. Black women artists, some of whom are trained as architects, such as Turquoise Dyson, Lauren Halsey, and Amanda Williams, have centered architecture thinking in a deeply complex Black feminist ethos and are defining innovative practices that integrate architecture and art within broader social and spatial power dynamics. This also is fertile territory for architecture theory. Ideology without a conception of the political produces the effect of being political while remaining silent on the power dynamics that really matter. Ideology and epistemology, as I hope to allude to and articulate today, are twin components of power structures having to do with beliefs on the one hand and knowledge production on the other. Architecture is both a discipline and a practice, is now in a position to reconstruct its destiny, just as academic and cultural institutions, such as the Museum of Modern Art and others, now have an opportunity to take corrective action against their own historical absences and silences. So architecture, race theory, my contribution, and reconstructions of the upcoming show could very well function as one of many potential inaugural moments of thought on reparations and coalescing of architecture, race theory as a discourse for racial transformation. Now I want to go into the Paul Williams archive and kind of try to synergize this discussion with some images and a discussion of Paul Williams himself. What you're viewing right now is a work by Mark Bradford, who I think is an incredible contemporary artist who does in a way take abstraction and the social together to make compelling work that draws you in, I think speaks to a kind of aesthetic, a kind of location, non-location that is very compelling. I think this is, I just want to contrast a couple of examples of Black aesthetics, contemporary Black aesthetics, with some other work that I'm going to show later. Similarly, Lauren Halsey, who was trained as an architect for, I believe, a year or two, her work in thinking about how to visually convey in the form of kind of artistic installations, the space of neighborhood culture and aesthetics, I think is very compelling and again, draws you into a world that's very speculative, imaginative, but also very knowable and in a way nostalgic at the same time. We acquired the Paul Revere Williams Archives, co-acquired it in a 50-50 partnership with the Getty Foundation in June of this year. And the archive consists of about 35,000 items. We think there's about 3,600 architectural projects represented in the archive. I say we think because it exists right now in about 500 to 600 tubes that hold rolls of drawings. And when you pick a tube and unroll drawings, you get some of the things that are indexed to be in that tube, but you also get other things and other projects that that add to what we thought was in there. So it's quite extraordinary. We also have photographs and some personal effects from Paul Williams. And I just want to, just a little bit about Paul Williams, because many people may not know his work, but Paul Williams was, a graduate of USC Architecture. He very interestingly, was born in Los Angeles. He was orphan, foster child, born in Los Angeles, 1894. And the majority of his projects are in Southern California, Los Angeles, Palm Springs. But he also had an office in Bogota, Colombia, and worked on projects across Latin America in Colombia, Cuba, and many places. And we're talking about 1921-ish when he started his practice. I believe he graduated around between 1916-1918 and worked until the late 1970s. As I said, we think there's about 3,600 projects. You of course, know some that I'll show in a moment, but really an extraordinary individual and an extraordinary architect who worked alongside many other contemporaries of his time, particularly in Los Angeles, including Welton Becket, A. Quincy Jones, who was a Cornell graduate. He did probably 25 to 30 projects with A. Quincy Jones. He coordinated and worked with Welton Becket on the LAX theme building, LAX terminal, Los Angeles Airport, and several other projects. And many people who visited Los Angeles will know many of his residential projects, and also cultural and hotel projects, the Beverly Hills Hotel, Los Angeles County Courthouse, et cetera. Many, many projects that span residential, commercial, cultural. And I want to, I can come back to slides when we get into the Q&A, but we don't, again, have the archives available to us yet. So again, this is a conversation with myself on how we're going to begin to approach it. But I just want to move through a couple of things that are appearing to me as intuitively, given what I know and have learned about Paul Williams and the archives, that I want to kind of bring up and then explore architecture race theory as a kind of maybe one methodology that one might use to kind of think about his work. First of all, Paul Williams is primarily known as a residential architect. And one of the things that we'll be doing with the archives and working with the Getty in their African American art initiative, which they started several years ago, purchasing the Ebony Jet Photographic Archives and Betty Sard's archives, working with them and LACMA, who will be an exhibition partner, is really to reintroduce Paul Williams as a much more complete architect than simply, but then a residential architect only, an architect to the stars. And one of the things that intuitively has concerned me about Paul Williams is, and maybe it's just my own, because of my own history as being steeped in modernism, having to kind of assimilate to the modernist thinking as a student, is his dismissal as a kind of important modernist architect or modern architect because of the eclecticism of the genres within which he worked, particularly in the residential category. And I just wanted to go through a couple of slides to show that Paul Williams is not alone in that, in having a corpus of his work be eclectic. And this is a show de force by Le Corbusier, of course, one of the major icons of modern architecture. And then we also understand Le Corbusier to be the architect of Villa Savoy and many other residential projects that are quite modern. When we think about the way in which Le Corbusier is analyzed and interpreted, it has very much to do with kind of this idea of the syncretism and synthesis between classical principles and kind of translating those into a modern ethos, both in terms of technology, materiality, spatial proportion, et cetera. And so there's a kind of tethering of Le Corbusier to the classical past, so to speak, in very broad terms. And this has not been done with Paul Williams, but it could be, because I think the nexus is there when we look at the corpus of the work. And I just put that out there as kind of a way to kind of start the process of allowing Paul Williams to be as complete an architect as we see some of his contemporaries. I had the opportunity to visit Venezuela. I was in Caracas in 2015 and got to see the Central University in Caracas done by Carlos Villanueva, a fantastic Venezuelan architect. Well, the entire campus was designed by him, which is quite amazing. It's a huge campus. It's designed very much in a kind of genre of Corbusian modernism. But Carlos Villanueva also did projects like the one on the right. And again, early in his career, translated between these two eclectic, several eclectic genres, and ends up producing a tremendously modernist campus like this. He also produced public housing like this as well. And so I'm want to begin to think about Paul Williams, you know, through the lens of a more complete process. Many of you know the story that Paul Williams sketched upside down because he wanted to use his talents to communicate with clients who weren't comfortable sitting side by side because he was black and they were white. Even sketching not upside down is a skill that many of us appreciate, and to do that upside down is even more telling of the pure talent of Paul Williams, the ability to use his skills in the toolkit to get projects and to sustain an incredible practice. I also want to think about Paul Williams, you know, the man and the work in terms of the professional identity linking with his personal identity. Now, it might not be the case that Welton Becket or other architects who were white had to even think about their whiteness with respect to their clients. But Paul Williams had to think about that every single meeting. I was told stories by Karen Hudson and others about when he was working at the Beverly Hills Hotel, and he was had site meetings, and his team was there, mostly white in some cases, and he couldn't get in without the owner calling up the front desk and saying, you know, yes, Paul Williams is black, and he's the architect that we're working with. And so this idea of the being under constant surveillance in doing your work is something that I think we can't divorce from the analysis of the work itself. And the work is extraordinary. And I just want to go through a couple of slides here. These are large residences. Paul Williams had some of the largest residences in Los Angeles at the time and still remain quite substantial today. I'm not going to go into detail, but I just want to show some of the extraordinary range of work that he did. And these are houses done, many of them for Hollywood stars that were emerging. Desi Arnaz, Frank Sinatra, Lucille Ball, I believe this is Frank Sinatra's home. Some of these, unfortunately, are destroyed. Some are remain in the hands of great owners, taking good care, and some are in various levels of disrepair, and that's something that we'll be looking at as we do programming over the course of the next several years. Paul Williams also did a fair amount of public housing, and I think you know, thinking about public housing done by an architect of extraordinary skill is something that I think we want to look into. This is that was, I believe, Pueblo del Rio. This is another public housing project, and I think these will bear fruit as we look at kind of thinking about the residential projects in relation to these projects and the different kind of movements that are happening between strategies that he's using. A church, Paul Williams did all kind of buildings. This is a hotel in Medellin, Colombia, out of his office in Colombia. This is, of course, the Beverly Hills Hotel. That's his handwriting. He did an addition and also several interior spaces. The Golden State West Mutual Building that's built in Los Angeles in the black part of the black community. LAX terminal building. And then Paul Williams did a fair amount of speculative projects. This was an idea for a tram, an elevated tram transit system in Los Angeles. Boy, that would be great to have today. We are building more transit in Metro, but you know, to have this kind of thinking back in the 1930s, 40s, 50s is quite extraordinary. So I think this will bear fruits for us as well. I think the kind of analysis that we, you know, again, can appropriate from architectural history that can give us more insight and intelligence around, you know, the formal and technical aspects of his work, I think will be used. I just show, you know, arbitrary examples here, but I think this is the kind of analysis that the work deserves, both the residential, cultural, and institution work. And I want to just end perhaps by going through the four tenets of that I laid out before and seeing if I could think about those with respect to Paul Williams. And so when we think about the work and we think about, again, the professional identity and the personal identity, the way in which Paul has approached abstraction, I think, will be very interesting. The way that he approached the idea of pictorial representation, the idea of simulacra. I mean, many of the residential projects are derivative stylistically, but also in a way a kind of stage set. And I think developing a kind of framework around what that simulacra actually, what the intentions behind that were, both interior and exterior, will be interesting. And of course, figurative representation as well. And so I think that with respect to using critical theory as a reparative intellectual method for making race visible in canonical American and European architecture discourses, I think looking at a comparative analysis of public housing projects done by Williams alongside high-end residential, I think we're going to find tactics and strategies that are actually mixing. And I think that will be very interesting. I think that cultural projects and municipal projects, again, I think we'll find tactics where banks and community churches and things like that achieve and are endowed with the kind of grandness and civicness that are more akin to public and municipal projects. And so I'm interested in looking for the syncretism between those kind of building types. In terms of using critiques of neoliberalism and capitalism to analyze the role of race in producing inequity, I think looking at the neighborhoods in which Paul Williams projects are built, how landscape is used, how natural and kind of man-made barriers are used to produce exclusion or inclusion in public housing projects and high-end private residential projects, I think will be interesting. Of course, subjecting them to these projects to criticism, fair criticism as well. What's the level of segregation in the neighborhoods working, the time the buildings are produced? And then we can look at them today and some of those and say, you know, how did the restricted covenants and things like that actually produce more exclusion or more inclusion over time as his projects kind of align in state, in a sense, in these neighborhoods that are changing and evolving? And what impact, if any, did his projects have in the urban development of those conditions? Third, using creative and analytical tools of architecture thinking and design to reintroduce a race-integrated imagination. Again, I'd like to think about the Latin America projects, which might give Paul Williams the opportunity to experiment and to be more provocative than he might have been able to do in the constrained environment of the racially conscious American context. I don't know, but it might be an opportunity to kind of see him moving out of a certain kind of shell potential. And finally, to instrumentalize the exceptional global narrative of the African diaspora as fundamental to the evolution of egalitarianism as an ideological concept and core to the democratic ideal, I'm very interested in how Paul Williams saw his personal and professional identity connection as having an impact on improving the betterment of the communities in which he built, Black community of which he was a part of in Los Angeles, and the broader community. How did he see his personal story and his professional accomplishments impacting the world in a particular way? So with that, Thank you, and I'll stop there and I open up to Q&A.
Thank you so much, Milton. That was a remarkable and informative conversation. Very, very appreciative on our end of your bringing that thought leadership to the work that needs to be done. I'm opening up the Q&A now for our cohort to feed some questions in our direction. But while I'm waiting for those to queue in, I did want to just ask a question about the archive. And I realize that you're still unpacking it or just on the verge of unpacking it. But are you aware of much written content that came from Williams? Is there much included in terms of correspondence or any dialogue or monologue?
Yes and no. So, you know, when I came, there's so many stories, and I've only been here 3 years, but when I came to USC in 2017, I started immediately a conversation with Karen Hudson, Paul Williams' granddaughter, and I would be remiss if I didn't say how indebted the world is to her for stewarding the archives. She wrote two books published by Rizzoli, I think one or two of them, but they're two books that that have a lot of his work in it and great textual content as well. And so many thought, and I was told when I got here, that the archives had been destroyed in the fire in 1992 as a result of the riots and protests in South LA. So at the end of Paul Williams's practice, his office was located in Golden State in the Mutual Savings Building, where his, I'm not going to get this right, but his his nephew, I believe, ran that bank. And so he had an office there. And it was thought that everything was lost in the fire. So the building did burn down. And essentially what was destroyed were a lot of his personal business records were destroyed. And so not all of them, but most of them. And prior to that point, Karen and I believe her brother had moved. They'd moved all the architectural drawings out of that situation, and they were already secure. And so what we have in the archives is all the architectural drawings, no models, and there's other personal effects, some business records that are also included that we will go through. And so I don't know what extent those are there. It's also going to be piecing him together with other people he worked with, and there may be communications that are in some other archives, for example. So I don't really know exactly what we're going to find there.
Got it. One question that's coming in. Will you plan to engage students in the archaeological process of going through the onboarding of the archives?
So yes and no. So the way we divide and conquer here is the we own it 50-50 with the Getty Foundation, the Getty Research Institute. It will be stored at a Getty facility, and they will do the conservation and digitization. Will contribute to half of that, and their professional staff will do that. As they're doing that, things will get rolled out and disseminated digitally for the public and scholars. And then every so often, there will be the opportunity for things to be available for scholars and students and others to come in and actually view those in person. And so the Getty has a wonderful fellowship program. We're looking to partner with them on that so that we can bring in fellows that will be doing teaching and research and bringing students into the archives, but also bringing the archives into the school in terms of teaching around the archives. It could be, again, the development of modern LA, with, you know, through the lens of some of the work that Paulings has done in some of the archives that are being uncovered. So yes, yeah, students will definitely be engaged in a lot of different ways.
That's fantastic. Very exciting to think about the possibility there. As one who sits within an archive, you know, we think a lot about ways in which we can disseminate and use our assets as teaching tools. So I'm sure that many opportunities will present themselves as you dig out, so to speak.
Yeah, and of course the Getty has, they have the Frank Gehry archives, I believe, up to Disney. They're just finishing scanning and digitizing that, and then they'll start on the Paul Williams work after that. And then they also have Julia Shulman photographs. He photographed a lot of Paul Williams' work. Some of the images I showed tonight are Julia Shulman photographs from the Getty collection. And then they also have Welton Beckett archives. And so there's a lot of connectivity between some of the archives they already have and Paul Williams, and also the African American archive that they have.
Great. Let's see, another question is coming in. Can you talk more about the acquisition of the archives and how that happened? I think they're referring to your relationship with Williams' daughter and so forth.
Sure. So, you know, I don't have experience with these kinds of things. And so I really just listened to people tell me that this was an important archive. Of course, when I came, Paul Williams had just been awarded the AIA Gold Medal, the highest honor of the American Institute of Architects, posthumously, the only Black person to receive that. And our school had also honored him that same year, just before I arrived in 2017, at what is called our USC Architectural Guild annual dinner, and honored him as an annual alumni award winner posthumously. So I talked with Karen. We met and I think developed important level of trust and respect for both the work that she had done, what was doing, continues to do in terms of stewarding the archives, and also just making sure that the archive, you know, did not fall into hands that would not take care of it. So I think there was a mutual respect there. We're both Black American. We both grew up in California, and we understand the challenges that Paul Williams had to go through and that many Black architects still have to go through in navigating race in this country. And so there's a lot of, you know, there are a lot of common threads there. I think when we got to the kind of, you know, brass tacks, it was, you know, is USC the right place to house this in perpetuity? And our position was yes, but with a great partner. And we're lucky in LA to have the Getty, that's a very excellent partner, had just not too long before our partnership began, had acquired the Ebony Jet Archives and had announced the African American Initiative, which is very important for them and very, very much sends a signal as a huge institution that they are, that this is important. And what they said when I began to engage them as a potential partner, they said the African American Art History Initiative is not complete without African American architects. Mm. And that to me really kind of sealed the deal that they were the right partner, because they included architects in the kind of cultural visual production that needs to be preserved and theorized and historicized. And I think that's exactly kind of on the same page where I was. So, you know, these things are partially luck and a little bit of being in the right place at the right time, but I think everything worked out to the better, and I think to everybody's satisfaction.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Curry, for this fascinating lecture. Looking forward to the forthcoming exhibition and your continued work with the Williams Archive. In the context within which he was working in the US, Mr. Williams seems to have been creating work that was commissioned largely by white male clients, organizations, municipalities. You referred to the potential dichotomy between work in Central America and US. What types of differences at a macro level do you see in the types of projects and the architecture created between the US and Central America?
Yeah, it's a good question. Again, I'm really having a conversation with myself here because, you know, I've pulled several, opened several mini tubes from the archives to get a sampling of what's there and still just scratch the surface. So I'm not sure there's going to be a difference. I just intuitively am thinking that there may be, because you hit different clients and different cultural sensibilities, of course. Latin America has a very different relationship to modernism than the United States. They're, you know, whether you go to Medellin, Bogota, Caracas, Havana, Mexico City, you know, they're sitting within a colonial context that's already built. And then they have, you know, their own indigenous modern architects like Carlos Villanueva, who have created, like Mario Pani in Mexico City and in Brazil, Oscar Niemeyer, you know, have the capacity through labor and obviously various dictatorial relationships that governments have had there to do these incredible modernist projects that really dwarf even some of the European modernist opportunities that they had in Europe. And so that's the context in which he's walking into, right in the middle of that, with his office. And I just am curious as to how their sensibility, how their approach to race, which can be just as racist or more as the US, by the way, but there also could be different kind of people represented there in communities. I just don't know, but I just anticipate that there's going to be some difference potentially. And I'm just going to enjoy kind of letting that unfold as we get into the archives.
Sure. Well, I'm going to move to the last question, which I can tell is coming from one of our graduate students, who happens to be a Brazilian industrial designer. And her question is, well, she says, "Good evening, Milton. My question is, if you can picture how architecture would look today if Black architects had more visibility in the past."
Yeah, that's a great question. I think it's a complex question. I think what I try to do in kind of developing this idea of architecture race theory is to say that just because you're Black doesn't mean you're going to do something amazing. Just because you're white doesn't mean you're going to do something amazing either. And so I think you have to look at kind of the educational pedigree and construct that people are coming out of, what kind of sensibility and consciousness they have of history, theory, all the conceptual levers and toolkits that allow you to make your own way. The interesting thing about Paul Williams, he kind of curated his education. He didn't go into kind of assimilating into, you know, a purity test modernist program. He went to technical schools, he went to USC, he went to other kinds of schools to get different kinds of knowledge. And I think that then unlocks your own destiny versus going to a one-stop shop where you're really locked into buying into and assimilating into a certain ideology and pedagogy. So I think that all those things are in play as you look critically at kind of what the future could be, as well as what the future could have been had Black Americans had been afforded as much opportunity as their white counterparts. I will say that part of the licensing of architects in this country is racialized. There were Black artisans and craftsmen who couldn't become licensed architects because they were Black. And so they did work constructing things and making things, some of them buildings, some of them installations that approach the scale of buildings, that could not call themselves architects. And so what could they have done? They could have you know, they could have built things and could have built things with a different sensibility and different consciousness than was the case with others who were building things without their history and background, et cetera.
Right. Thank you. That's a great, I think, way to close. And I just want to thank you for all the wisdom and insight. I'm thrilled to know that you're at the helm and at the nexus of so many important projects. I'm really very much looking forward to sharing the MoMA exhibition when it comes out and the corresponding content within our cohort beyond. And I want to thank you for being our Vignelli lecturer tonight. Looking forward to more collaboration in the future, and please keep us abreast of the exciting developments that your important work is bringing up.
And you the same. Thank you so much, Josh. I appreciate the opportunity and also the ongoing friendship and mutual respect for the great work that you're doing. So, thank you.
Thank you very much. Have a great night. And thanks again.
Thank you.
Good night, everyone.